Do you see that database over there? It is just sitting there full of data. I do not know about you, but I really want to scan the data that lies within. To get a look inside that database, I need to write a query, a very precise query. So, let's do this. Let's learn about the select statement. I'm going in. Hold my drink. Databases can have many, many tables. With the select command, you can retrieve data from one table or multiple tables with a technique called joins. Today, we will focus on using the select statement to get data from a single table. We will push the select statement to its limit, and then we will push some more. We will use a table called earthquake. It contains data on all earthquakes with a magnitude of 5.5 or greater from 1969 through 2018. This table contains 10 columns: earthquake ID, occurred on, latitude, longitude, depth, magnitude, calculation method, network ID, place, and cause. This data was retrieved from the U.S. Geological Survey, one of the top sources for information about tectonic activity. The earthquake ID is the primary key of this table. The primary key is a value that uniquely identifies each row in the table. The next four columns tell you when and where the earthquake occurred, with the depth measured in kilometers. The calculation method is a code for the formula used to compute the magnitude. Do not fear the math. Embrace it. The network ID is an alternative key generated by the contributor of the data. The place is a human-readable value of where on Earth the quake occurred. And then there is the cause, which we will discuss later. A CSV of the data used in this video is available from Socratica on GitHub. It is only 2 megabytes in size and is waiting for you to download. So create your table and import the data, because it's time to shake, rattle, and roll, and query. I will be using pgadmin, since I'm using Postgres as my database. But all examples should work on any newfangled relational database the kids are using these days. For our first query, we will select all data from the earthquake table. This query contains 2 essential parts. The select statement lists the columns you want data for, and the from statement specifies which tables to select data from. When you use an asterisk, that instructs the database to return all columns, even the shy ones. Now execute. How do you like them apples? You can see that all 10 columns were included. In many SQL tools, the first column is the record or row number. This is not data from the table. It simply numbers the results for you. If you're using pgadmin, you can click the Messages tab to see how long the query took and how many rows were affected. And we see there are 23,119 rows in this table. Let me get this straight. There have been over 23,000 earthquakes of magnitude 5.5 or greater in the past 50 years. That is more than one per day. Easy there, Mother Earth. Maybe try some hot yoga. But there is another way to find the number of rows in this table. Use the count function. That is right, my friends. There are functions you can use in your queries. For this query, we will select a count rather than the data itself. Count is a function, and the input can be either an asterisk or the name of a column. We will use an asterisk to ensure we count all rows. Execute. The result is a single number, 23,119. Notice that the name of the column in the row set is count. This is the name of the function, not the name of any column in our table. I would like to raise one more issue. Speed. Let us execute the first query again. And note how many milliseconds it took to execute. But if you use the count function, it is noticeably faster. To a single person, the difference may not be perceptible. But if your database is being used by thousands or millions of users, then milliseconds matter. So strive for peak performance. You want to be a lean, mean, clean coding machine. For our next query, we will be more selective in how we use select. Instead of fetching all columns, let us be more specific. This time, we will only select the magnitude, place, and occurred on columns. Execute. We can select the columns in any order that we please. If you would prefer, you could select the place before the magnitude. Execute. And admire. In addition to the select and from keywords, there is a third valuable part of queries, the where clause. You specify the columns you want with the select keyword, but you specify the rows with the where clause. For example, let us select all earthquakes that occurred on or after January 1st, 2000. Execute. If you scan the rows with your eyeballs, you will see that all of the earthquakes listed did occur on or after January 1st, 2000. The database obeyed our command, like a tiny little digital puppy that is well trained in SQL. Who's a good boy? Who fetched all that data for me? Let us now answer a very specific question using SQL. What was the largest earthquake in 2010? First, we need our query to only select quakes from 2010. We do this by requiring the occurred on field to be on or after January 1st, 2010, and also on or before December 31st, 2010. Execute. This query returned 559 rows. I do not know about you, but I am in no mood to scroll through 559 rows to try to find the largest earthquake. And with SQL, we do not have to. We can improve our query by sorting the quakes by magnitude. To do this, add an order by clause. After order by, specify the column to sort on. Execute. The query did sort by magnitude, but it sorted in ascending order. Let me get this straight. To find the answer, I would have to scroll to the end of the results. I refuse. Instead, let us sort by magnitude in descending order. To do this, add the desk keyword after the column name. Execute. And there we have it. The largest earthquake in 2010 was an 8.8 quake off the coast of Chile that happened on February 27th. While we answered our question, there is still room for improvement. The database returned 559 rows, but we were only interested in the first one. We can take pity on our computer and restrict the number of rows returned with the limit keyword. At the end of the query, write limit and the number of rows you would like. To answer our question, we only need one row. Execute. There we have it, a clean, efficient query that answers our question. This query showcases the structure of many queries. To fetch data from a table, start your query with select and specify the columns you want. An asterisk means you want all columns. Next, the from keyword is used to pick the table. You can restrict which rows are returned with a where clause. There can be one or more search criteria separated by logical words like and or. Now that you have chosen the rows and columns, you can sort the data with an order by clause. You can sort a column in ascending or descending order. And if you want to restrict the number of rows returned by your query, specify a limit. Congratulations! I did a great job! You have now seen the main parts of a select query, but this is only the beginning. There is much more you can do, so get ready to take your select skills from here to here. Because after a few more of our videos, you will be in a select group of engineers. Soon there will be no limit to where you will go. At this point, most YouTube channels would ask you to like, subscribe, comment, and share. But we order our calls to action by action. So please, comment, like, share, and subscribe.